worship at Christus. As you've noticed, I am not Pastor Newman. I am Pastor Reed. I serve Bethany in Fort Atkinson, and Pastor Newman has asked me to help fill in for him today. We worship, beginning with our opening hymn, Christ is our Cornerstone. Deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, and will forgive us our sins, and purify us from all unrighteousness.
Let us confess our sins to the Lord. Holy God, gracious Father, I confess that I am sinful by nature, and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have not loved you with my whole heart. I have not loved others as I should. I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But Jesus, my Savior, paid for my sins with his innocent suffering and death. Trusting in him, I pray, God, have mercy on me, a sinner.
Our gracious Father in heaven has been merciful to us. He sent his only Son, Jesus Christ, who gave his life as the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In the peace of forgiveness, let us praise the Lord by singing hymn 938.
Thank you.
Almighty and everlasting God, you are always more ready to hear than we are ready to pray. And you always give us more than we either desire or deserve. Pour upon us the abundance of your mercy, forgiving us our sins, and giving us those good things for which we are not worthy to ask. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. The first reading is from the book of Exodus, chapter 16. We hear again about Moses giving manna to the Israelites, and yet it's not Moses who gives it to them, but it's God. When the Israelites saw it, they said to each other, "What is it?" For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, "It is the bread the Lord has given you to eat. This is what the Lord has commanded. Each one is to gather as much as he needs. Take an omer for each person you have in your tent." The Israelites did as they were told. Some gathered much, some little. And when they measured it by the omer, he who gathered much did not have too much, and he who gathered little did not have too little. Each one gathered as much as he needed. Then Moses said to them, "No one is to keep any of it until morning." However, some of them paid no attention to Moses. They kept part of it until morning, but it was full of maggots and began to smell. So Moses was angry with them. Each morning, everyone gathered as much as he needed, and when the sun grew hot, it melted away. On the sixth day, they gathered twice as much, two omers for each person, and the leaders of the community came and reported this to Moses. He said to them, "This is what the Lord commanded. Tomorrow is to be a day of rest, a holy Sabbath to the Lord. So bake what you want to bake, and boil what you want to boil. Save whatever is left and keep it until morning." So they saved it until morning, as Moses commanded, and it did not stink or get maggots in it. "Eat it today," Moses said, "because today is a Sabbath to the Lord. You will not find any of it on the ground today. 6 days you are to gather it, but on the seventh day, the Sabbath, there will not be any." Nevertheless, some of the people went out on the seventh day to gather it, but they found none. Then the Lord said to Moses, "How long will you refuse to keep my commands and my instructions? Bear in mind that the Lord has given you the Sabbath. That is why on the sixth day he gives you bread for 2 days. Everyone is to stay where he is on the seventh day. No one is to go out." So the people rested on the seventh day. The people of Israel called the bread manna. It was white like coriander seed, and tasted like wafers made with honey. These are the words of our Lord.
Praise be to God.
We speak Psalm 145 responsively. I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together.
I saw the Lord.
The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him, and he delivers them.
Taste and see that the Lord is good.
The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are attentive to their cry.
The righteous person may have many trials, but the Lord delivers him from them all.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. The second reading is from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 10. Paul warns the Corinthians that even though all of the Israelites received the same spiritual food, not all of them were able to enter into God's rest in the promised land. "For I do not want you to be ignorant of the fact, brothers, that our forefathers were all under the cloud, and that they all passed through the sea.
They were all baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. They all ate the same spiritual food and drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank from the spiritual rock that accompanied them, and that rock was Christ. Nevertheless, God was not pleased with most of them. Their bodies were scattered over the desert. These things happened to them as examples and were written down as warnings for us, on whom the fulfillment of the ages has come. So if you think you are standing firm, be careful that you don't fall. No temptation has seized you except what is common to man. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can stand up under it. These are the words of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the gospel. The gospel lesson is John chapter 6. Jesus begins his bread of life discourse. Once the crowd realized that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they got into the boats and went to Capernaum in search of Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the lake, they asked him, "Rabbi, when did you get here?" Jesus answered, "I tell you the truth, you are looking for me, not because you saw miraculous signs, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. Do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. On him God the Father has placed his seal of approval." Then they asked him, "What must we do to do the works God requires?" Jesus answered, "The work of God is this, to believe in the one he has sent." So they asked him, "What miraculous sign then will you give that we may see it and believe you? What will you do? Our fathers ate the manna in the desert. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." Jesus said to them, "I tell you the truth, it is not Moses who has given you bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." "Sir," they said, "from now on, give us this bread." This is the gospel of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. The sermon hymn is hymn 839.
Thank you.
selected verses. For I am already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time for my departure is near. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. At my first defense, no one came to my support, but everyone deserted me. May it not be held against them. But the Lord stood by my side and gave me strength, so that through me the message might be fully proclaimed, and all the Gentiles might hear it. And I was delivered from the lion's mouth. The Lord will rescue me from every evil attack, and will bring me safely to his kingdom, to his heavenly kingdom. To him be glory forever and ever. Amen. This is our text, brothers and sisters. Grace be to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Do you wonder what it was like for Paul as he was imprisoned in Rome for the second time, as he awaited trials, hearings, and eventually his own execution? Or what about his prison arrangements? Was he kept in a cold, damp cell underground? Or did he perhaps have some amount of freedom, some measure of independence under house arrest, like he did during his first Roman imprisonment? What was Paul thinking about as these legal proceedings took place, as he undoubtedly had to wait time and time again for his sentence to be passed? It would have been easy, very easy, for Paul's thoughts to turn inward, for him to brood, to cycle back over and over again to how things could have gone differently, so that he could have avoided being arrested again, so that he could have avoided being taken to Rome as a prisoner for the second time. But actually, Paul's thoughts turned outward, and it was to young pastor Timothy that Paul's thoughts turned. He thought of his ministry partner and mentee. He thought of saying goodbye to the one who had traveled so far by his side on those missionary journeys. He thought of giving one final ministry encouragement to his fellow servant of Christ. And so, as Paul put pen to paper for maybe the last time, he addressed Timothy with the simultaneous tenderness and sternness of a father addressing his son. And for 3.5 chapters, Paul speaks almost exclusively about Timothy and what Timothy should be prepared for. And only at the very end does Paul turn his attention back to himself, to his own situation. And what he says then, when he turns his attention to himself, is frankly unbelievable. Because Paul says God is going to deliver him from evil. Now, you and I, we look objectively at Paul's situation and we think, there's no way God's going to deliver him from evil. With him imprisoned, due to be condemned, and soon to be counting down the days to his execution, it's like a death row inmate saying, things are looking up for him in the future, and not because some new evidence has been found that will overturn his conviction, or because he got a new lawyer who's going to appeal his sentence. Or it's like a company that's having everything go catastrophically wrong in a very public way, saying that it expects increased profits next quarter. It's just because Paul fully expects and knows that the time of his departure, meaning his death, is near. But that's just it, isn't it? Therein lies the tension between what we mean when we ask God to deliver us from evil, and how God actually intends to deliver us from evil. We believe that God delivering us from evil means something like protecting us from bodily harm, giving our nation peace, security, stability, and protection from its enemies, preventing terroristic threats, and generally dissipating unrest in the world. We wrongly assume that the happier we are, the more we've been delivered from evil. Which is why, when suffering comes to visit one of us Christians, one might think it calls into question whether God really is delivering her from evil. Whether he's keeping his promise, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. Whether he's really working all things together for the good of those who love him. And those thoughts have a certain amount of logic to them, don't they? Because after all, God's protection of believers absolutely encompasses guarding and delivering you from physical and emotional suffering. And if we really believe that God knows all and that he works all in all, then couldn't he prevent us from enduring this pain? Couldn't he stop this evil in its tracks from attacking us? Take, for example, the vision that Paul received from God when he was in Corinth during his third missionary journey. God said to him, "Do not be afraid. Keep on speaking. Do not be silent. For I am with you, and no one is going to attack and harm you, because I have many people in this city." Or take God destroying Pharaoh's army in the Red Sea during the Exodus. And I could go on like this for quite some time, giving more and more examples of God delivering and protecting his people from physical harm. So then, what gives? Doesn't God want to protect us? Doesn't he go with us wherever we go? Isn't he with us always to the very end of the age? Isn't he powerful enough to frustrate the designs of our enemies? Let's think for a moment about how Paul resolved this tension, how Paul thought about this issue. Because Paul had received special divine protection in the past, in Corinth, like I mentioned. Yet there was no expectation, as he writes to Timothy near the end of his life, there's no expectation this time God is going to intervene to prevent his death. Instead, Paul writes to Timothy saying that he is already being poured out like a drink offering, using sacrificial language that echoed his own words in Romans 12. "I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship." But in Romans chapter 12, Paul was talking about the believer's life of sanctification. Here, he's talking about his own impending death, because he says the time for his departure from this life is near. In the sermon text, Paul alludes to his first defense. This could have been a preliminary hearing regarding these charges that were being brought against him. And at this first defense, Paul says, no one supported him. No one stood by him. whether he had some friend or patron or colleague in Rome whom he thought he could rely on to speak up on his behalf as a witness or a defense attorney. Things didn't play out that way. Now the writing's on the wall. Paul knows he's not long for this world. And yet, he has the spirit-breathed, spirit-worked confidence to say that the Lord had stood by his side and would deliver him from every evil attack. Now, I think Paul was much more aware of all the evil attacks that were aimed against him than we are. In fact, in 2 Corinthians, Paul even boasts about all the ways that he suffered for Christ. 5 times I received from the Jews the 40 lashes minus one. 3 times I was beaten with rods. 1 I was pelted with stones. 3 I was shipwrecked. I spent a night and a day in the open sea. I've been in danger from rivers, in danger from bandits, in danger from my fellow Jews, in danger from Gentiles, in danger in the city, in danger in the country, in danger at sea, and in danger from false brothers. Add to that all the occasions where people tried to assassinate Paul, and it's clear Paul went through a lot of attacks. But even more dangerous than those physical attacks against Paul's body were the attacks against his soul, the attacks of Satan. He wrote, "In order to keep me from becoming conceited, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan, to torment me." Paul also suffered the attacks of his own sinful nature. "For what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do. For I know that good itself does not dwell in me, that is, in my sinful nature. For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out." That's the familiar Romans 7 struggle that faces each and every one of us. And there it is. Each of us faces enemies much more dangerous than those who want to make war against us or launch terror attacks, with much worse intentions and simply inflicting bodily harm to us. I'm talking about the unholy Trinity, the devil, the world, and our sinful flesh, which would like to see us suffering an eternity of torment in hell. Which is ultimately why Paul says God has delivered him from evil. That's why he points to the Lord and says, "He has stood by me and will continue to do so." Paul says, "I've fought the good fight. I've finished the race. I've kept the faith." Looking back on his ministry, not with carnal security. "No, if you think you're standing firm, watch out lest you fall." But with the spirit-inspired confidence grown from that word he had lived and breathed ever since the blinding light of the Lord Jesus had struck him on that road to Damascus and stopped him dead in his tracks. Ever since a little splash of water, the washing of rebirth and renewal in the Holy Spirit, had brought him into the grace of Christ's death and resurrection. And from now on, Paul says, the crown of righteousness is set aside, is reserved for him, and not only for him, but also for all who have longed for the Lord's appearing. And guess what? That means you. Because Christ's second coming, his return to judge the living and the dead, holds no terror for you who trust in him. Not so for sin and Satan. That can only be the case For you who know that your Savior, Jesus, won't allow anything to happen that can truly harm you. And that's ultimately why Paul had that confidence, that the Lord had remained with him, that the Lord had supported him and would continue to deliver him from evil. Because Paul knew nothing sin and Satan could do could harm what really mattered for him, his salvation from eternal death. And nothing sin and Satan can do can harm what really matters for you either. Your salvation rests secure because you rest in Jesus' arms. And doesn't the way Paul presents that truth just line up so well with what we know of salvation from the rest of Scripture? That crown, that victor's crown, namely righteousness that's set aside for you, which Christ freely gives as a gift. Doesn't that remind you of Paul's words to the Romans? But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness is given through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference between Jew and Gentile, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and all are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. And then Paul goes on to explain how Jesus won that righteousness for you, by being sacrificed and shedding his blood on the cross. So now perhaps we understand a little bit better what we're asking for when we pray in the Lord's Prayer that God would deliver us from evil. See these words of Paul to Timothy near the end of his life serve as a sort of commentary on that seventh petition of the Lord's Prayer, reminding us that our gospel-formed confidence in Christ assures us of his protection, even when he permits evil, even when he seems distant from us. That's kind of how I imagine Paul felt as he wrote 2 Timothy during those days of his final imprisonment leading up to his death. I imagine it was kind of like the way David felt, King David, as he wrote Psalm 22. Many bulls surround me, strong bulls of Bashan encircle me, roaring lions that tear their prey, open their mouths wide against me. Dogs surround me, a pack of villains encircles me. Rescue me from the mouth of the lions. And Paul knew. He knew that his prayer was answered. He said, I was delivered from the lion's mouth. And you, too, are delivered from the lion's mouth by another lion, the Lion of Judah, who crushed the serpent's head underfoot. To him be praise and glory now and forever. Amen. The peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard and keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. Please stand for the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Dear Lord, As in mercy you supplied the ancient Israelites with physical bread in the desert, in love you also give us our daily bread, all that we need for body and life. We praise and thank you for your abundant goodness to us. But above all, move us to appreciate and thank you always for your abundant grace in your Son, who is the living bread that came down from heaven for our eternal salvation. Trusting in him through the nourishment of your word and sacraments, we truly have all that we need, not only for this life, but also for the next. Preserve us from allowing the worries of this life or the deceitfulness of over-prioritizing earthly wealth to ever keep us from holding fast to Jesus our Savior. Instead, help us for our own sake and our children's to always cling to him as our most priceless treasure, as we order our footsteps day by day until the day you take us safely home. Compassionate Father, in your mercy you transform even sickness and disease into a blessing for your children. With this confidence, we commit all who are sick or suffering to your tender care. We pray especially for Darlene Pinot, who suffered a stroke this week. Provide healing and relief according to your infinite wisdom and boundless mercy. Grant patient endurance if her suffering must linger. Help her find true spiritual strength through Jesus and his cross during this time of physical weakness. By the work of the Holy Spirit, teach her to trust in your forgiveness, grace, and love. In Jesus' name we pray. And we pray as our Savior taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We continue with hymn 703.
Thank you.
we thank you for teaching us the things you want us to believe and do. Help us, by your Holy Spirit, to keep your word in pure hearts, that we may be strengthened in faith, guided in holiness, and comforted in life and in death, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Now receive with believing hearts the blessing of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
We sing our closing hymn. Blessed week in Christ.